All right, the title for the sermon this evening is called The Sin of Stupidity. So it's kind of a funny name, but honestly, the way things are going these days, it seems to be rampant stupidity. Now, the Bible has an outline. It gives, you know, in the Mosaic law, there are certain sacrifices that are to be given when a person sins through ignorance, right? The Bible, God still holds us responsible when you sin through ignorance. Now, ignorance and stupidity are not the same thing. If you're ignorant of something, it just means you don't know it. You know, you could be ignorant of a lot of things. A lot of things you've never heard before. For example, my wife, you know, when we got married, even her background, she was never brought up with the Bible at all. I mean, she had Christmas and Easter mixed up. She had no teaching of like biblical truth whatsoever. So I was kind of unfamiliar with that because I just thought that everyone had these certain, you know, common, I would think of it as like common knowledge, but she didn't have that. There's so much of the Bible she didn't have. So one of the things she had, and it was, you know, even before we got married, but obviously she got saved before we got married and things like that. But even being saved, you know, you don't know the whole Bible, right? You don't know everything it says until you know it, until you read it, until you've seen it, until you've heard it. That's when you know it. Until then, you're ignorant of it. So she was ignorant of the fact that, you know, drinking alcohol was a sin or getting drunk. She had no idea. She didn't even know that. She was ignorant of that. Now, if she were to go out and get drunk, is it still a sin? Absolutely. Of course it is. But, and she's still responsible for that. But she was, if she's ignorant of it, it's a little bit different. God has a little bit of mercy there. But he still says, hey, you've got a sin offering that you need to do. As soon as you find out that you were sinning through ignorance, you've got to take care of that. I'm not preaching on being ignorant tonight. Now, we ought to not be ignorant. I preach on stupidity. The sin of stupidity. And the way that, and I don't know what the definition, I didn't go look it up, but my definition of stupidity is you do know things and you still just choose to be a fool. You choose not, you know, it's not just because you haven't heard. You decide, you know, in the Bible term would probably be a fool or foolish. Being stupid. And really not using your brain. Okay? Not being able to reason. Some people, you know, I was talking about ignorance and sinning through ignorance. Some people are willfully ignorant. So keep your finger there in Proverbs 4 where we started. And I had you turn to 2 Peter chapter 3. Look at 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 3. The Bible says, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. But the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. See, it's talking about the last days. It's talking about people scoffing and saying, well, is Jesus supposed to come back? You know, it's been 2,000 years already. What do you mean he's coming back? It's been, you know, all this time has gone by. I don't think he really is coming back. And just mocking and scoffing and saying, you know, things have just been continuing along the way they have. Where is your God? Where is your Jesus? He's not coming. This is the way that the Bible predicted it was going to be. And I believe we're in the last days right now. But it says here that they were willingly ignorant. So they're not just ignorant, but they don't want to know. They don't want to know anything else. It says they're willingly ignorant of that by the word of God, the heavens were of old. They're willfully ignorant of what the Bible says about God's creation, about creating the heavens and creating the earth, and that God sent a flood upon the world to destroy the world because of the wickedness that man had wrought in the earth, and that he's going to judge the world again, and it's reserved on a day of fire. People are willfully ignorant of this. It's not that they don't know it, but as soon as they heard it, they'd want to know it. It's they don't know it, they don't want to know it. They don't have nothing to do with it. They have nothing to do with God. That falls under my definition of stupidity. You don't want to know. It's not that you're seeking the truth. It's not that you're interested in what's true and you have a desire to know what's true and whatever it is, it is. It's, I don't know anything about that. I don't want anything about that. I don't care about that. I just care about what makes me feel good or whatever. Let's go back, if you would, to Proverbs chapter 4. We're going to see here in Proverbs 4, the Bible places an emphasis on obtaining wisdom and getting knowledge. God wants us to be smart. God designed us as you. He gave us brains. He designed our bodies a particular way. He gave us soul, he gave us a spirit, and he gave us a brain. We need to be able to use what God has given us. Look at Proverbs 4. We're going to start reading there in verse number 4. Bible reads, "He taught me also and said unto me, let thine heart retain my words. Keep my commandments and live." He's talking about giving instruction, receiving instruction. And when he says, let thine heart retain my words, you know, oftentimes the heart, we could say, he's talking about his brain, right? He's talking about remembering these things. You keep something, you memorize something by heart. We know it's not that physical organ that is doing the retention of the memory. It's using your brain, but you keep it in your heart. You're keeping it with you. Let thine heart retain my words, keep my commandments and live. Get wisdom, get understanding, forget it not, neither decline from the words of my mouth. Forsake her not, and she shall preserve thee. Love her, and she shall keep thee. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. This is great instruction telling us, look, be smart, be wise, get knowledge, get understanding. So many people want to talk about, oh, you ignorant Christians. Look, you ought not to be an ignorant Christian. You ought not to be a stupid Christian. You ought to be someone who wants to know the truth, who loves wisdom, and who loves knowledge. And, you know, look, there's all types of people. You could have a faith in this book and still be one of the people I'm preaching against tonight. Okay? And a sin of stupidity. I think it's a shame for Christians not to be wise, not to have knowledge, to just believe whatever is just spoken from some man behind a pulpit somewhere, and to feel good that, like, you're just following someone else and just, I don't have a brain for myself. I can't think about these things. Well, I just believe because whatever so-and-so said. Shame on you for that. God doesn't want you to be like that. You ought to be able to challenge things. You ought to be able to know whether or not what you're hearing is right and true. You ought to have your own wisdom. You ought to have your own knowledge. There is an emphasis. There's a premium put on this. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And with all that getting, get understanding. Know what you're talking about. Know what you believe. Know what it is that God has for us. Know truth. Know wisdom. Too many people today just doesn't seem that important. Or they're putting an emphasis on a false wisdom, on a world's wisdom, right? And I won't say necessarily false, but a lot of it is. A lot of it's just lies. But let's keep reading. I want to keep going on this chapter before I even get off on that tangent. Verse number 8, exalt her, and she shall promote thee. She shall bring thee to honor when thou dost embrace her. So, as you know, so the feminine pronoun is referring to wisdom. Exalt her. What? Exalt wisdom. She shall promote thee. Wisdom will promote thee. All the good things that come from having wisdom, from being smart, from being wise. She shall bring thee to honor when thou dost embrace her. We should be openly embracing wisdom and knowledge, truth, righteousness. This is what is going to be good for us. She shall give to thine head an ornament of grace, a crown of glory. Shall she deliver to thee? Verse 10, hear, O my son, and receive my sayings, and the years of thy life shall be many. I have taught thee in the way of wisdom. I have led thee in right paths. When thou goest, thy steps shall not be straitened, and when thou runnest, thou shalt not stumble. Take fast hold of instruction. Let her not go. Keep her, for she is thy life. Now, this makes perfect sense. It's so simple. It's so rudimentary. But it needs to be preached, I think, over and over and over again, it seems. How do you receive wisdom in general? There's a couple ways you can receive wisdom. One is simply by experience, by doing. right? That is one way to attain wisdom. You just do things and you learn about them because you've gone through it. There's a lot of things I've learned, unfortunately, the hard way, because I had to go through it before I would actually listen to what someone else might want to tell me about it. You know, oftentimes, unfortunately, young people, teenagers, young adults, you know, they don't want to listen to the person warning them about the dangers of drugs and alcohol. They see other people, oh, it looks like so much fun. Oh, you don't know what you're talking about. Oh, what do you know? I know how to handle myself. It's not that big of a deal. Everything will be just fine. Until it's not. Until you actually have to go through it. Until you have to do something foolish. Until you get involved in a car accident. Until, you know, you overdose, or one of your friends does, or the countless things that happen as a result of being drunken or stoned or on drugs, you know, all the bad things that go along with that. You just have to experience it for yourself. Then you realize, wow, that was pretty stupid. That's one way of learning things. That's one way of getting wisdom. And that's actually, you know, one of the reasons why you generally have respect to what an older person will say, someone who's got a hoary head, just because they've been around for a long time. They've got some wisdom. But the better way to get wisdom is to learn, is to be instructed and to receive instruction from somewhere else, from someone else. We have instruction from the Bible. And what the instruction being given here, it's like a father to a son going, "Hear, my son, receive my sayings, and the years of thy life shall be many." If you listen to what I'm trying to explain to you right now, so you don't have to make all these mistakes, you could receive this wisdom, you could receive this knowledge, so you're not some dummy that just makes all the wrong choices in life, then the years of your life are going to be many. You're going to make the right choices. You're going to go down the right path. You're not going to be having all this hardship and all this drama and all these problems in your life that you would have if you made foolish choices. If you just listen, get the wisdom, get the instruction, and get the understanding. There's so much benefit there. Let's keep reading here. He says, verse 12, "When thou goest, thy steps shall not be straight." We read that already. Verse 13, "Take fast hold of instruction, let her not go. Keep her, for she is thy life." That is a high value putting on wisdom and instruction there. She is thy life. Hold on to wisdom. Get that understanding and instruction as if your life depends on it. That's knowledge. You know, some people like to think that get as much money as you can and hold on to that, and that's going to be, you know, that's success, that's going to make you happy, that's the end result, you know, hold on to that. That's vain and empty. You receive some wisdom right now, if that's what you're looking for, you're going to have a miserable life. Amen. You're going to be pierced through with many sorrows. That's what the love of money is going to bring you. I don't care how much money you have, if you've got wisdom, you got knowledge, you know right from wrong, you know the right choices to make, that's going to make all the difference in your life. All the difference. You need to be humble, though. You got to realize that you don't know everything in order to receive any type of wisdom, any type of instruction. As soon as you have that attitude that says, "Oh, well, I just know everything," no one could teach you. And I'll tell you what, right now, you don't. You don't know everything. I don't know everything. I try to explain that. I was out soul winning a day, and I was talking to a 19-year-old young man. He said he was an atheist, but then he said he was still open to the idea of a God and stuff. But what it turned out to be was that he didn't like the God of the Bible. That's what he didn't like. It's not that he really thought that there wasn't a God. He just thought that, well, I don't like this God, so I don't want to have anything to do with him. The good thing is that he was still relatively open to hearing something else, but as the conversation progressed, it almost seemed like there was nothing I could say to him at all to even be reasonable with to be able to come to some type of agreement or understanding it's one thing to disagree with somebody, right? We're not all going to agree on everything, you know. I've got what I believe to be true, and you, maybe that's a little bit different than what you believe, but when you just deny something out of hand, you answer a matter before you hear it, that's foolish. As the Bible says, you know, it's shame and folly. You know, if you answer a matter before you hear it, and that's true. You need to be, you know, how can you, you know, when you start to get to this level where you just, you know, you can't even be reasoned with, you can't even spoken to, you're too lifted up. We all need to be humble. Like, and I'm going to include myself in this category. Like, I don't know everything. So I need to stay humble. And that's hard as a teacher to be able to stay humble. I have a certain amount of wisdom and a certain amount of knowledge that I'm trying to instruct and teach here at this church. I've been deemed by other people as being qualified to do this. I think I am. And I'm sure that most of you here at least would agree with that. But I don't know everything. And in order for anyone to learn anything, you've got to be humble enough to recognize that and say, you know, there's areas where I need some more instruction. I need to be able to learn some more. And we need to be able to take fast hold of that instruction. When we hear something, you test it. Is this true? Is this a lie? Once you get the truth, you got to hold on to that truth and remember that and keep it. Bible says, take fast hold of instruction, let her not go, keep her, for she is thy life. Verse 14, enter not into the path of the wicked and go not in the way of evil men. Avoid it, pass not by it, turn from it and pass away. For they sleep not except they have done mischief, and their sleep is taken away unless they cause some to fall. For they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. This alone is good wisdom, talking about people who are wicked people. There's kids that are brought up in great homes and stuff, but they're never taught about, there are bad people out there. There are wicked people out there that are just bent on doing mischief, that drink the wine. They drink the wine of violence. They're just about getting into trouble. And you got to watch out for those people. That's a good advice. That's good warning and truth and letting you know, hey, there's bad people out there. You go around, you just walk around in life thinking that nobody's bad in this whole world. Unfortunately, you're going to end up learning the hard way, most likely. I mean, that's the way things are going to happen. If you just think everything's good, everybody's fine, nobody's bad, there's no wickedness, and you live your life that way, just a matter of time before the wicked person finds you, because you're going to be an easy mark, because they're going to see right away you've got your guard down, you don't know what's going on, you don't know the real world. We need to get wisdom. These people exist. We need to be aware of it. We need to be aware of their traits. We need to hear the wisdom and instruction from people who know the truth, and especially from God's word. Amen. Verse number 18, but the path of the just is as a shining light that shineth more and more unto the perfect day. The way of the wicked is as darkness. They know not at what they stumble. My son, attend to my words, incline thine ears unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart, for they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. Turn, if you would, to Proverbs 14. So we see Proverbs 4 goes on and on about the value and the, you know, of wisdom and of knowledge, and how important it is, and how we need to just receive that and hold on to that instruction as if it's for our life. The Bible talks about the simple in Proverbs 14. And when it talks about the simple, yeah, simple is not complicated, but simple is not a good term to be having referred to you. Simple means you're kind of stupid. You don't really know a lot. You're very ignorant. You don't know the way things work. And that's what the word that's used here in the Bible. Look at verse number 15 of Proverbs 14. The Bible says, the simple believeth every word, but the prudent man looketh well to his going. The simple believeth every word. A sign of stupidity is when people can tell you anything and you just believe it. And I'm gonna preach this time and time again. I don't care what church you're in or whatever. You don't just receive what you're told. You challenge it all. Know what you believe, why you believe it, and test it. Now, the one thing that I teach and I believe that we can take without having to question it is God's word. I mean, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, if you already put your faith in him, you have no reason not to believe the Bible as God's word. This is our authority. This is what we stand on. But I do think you still ought to be able to defend it as such. You ought to still be able to say, why do you believe the Bible? Why is this your source of authority? What is it that you have? What do you see in his book? Why do you have your faith in? in this book as God, just being God's word? You ought to be able to answer that. It's going to go a long way with you being able to try to convert people to believing on Jesus Christ, being able to answer that question. But if you're simple, if you're kind of stupid, you're not going to be able to do that. Now look, if you're simple because you're just ignorant and you haven't heard things before, just work at it. I mean, just keep studying, keep learning, you know, and move in the right direction. But don't be the one who's willfully ignorant and doesn't want to know, you know, well, I don't know that much, and I'm just not that smart, and I'm just going to be not smart the rest of my life because I'm just never been good at learning. Don't have that attitude. That's a stupid attitude. The Bible says here, the simple believeth every word, but the prudent man looketh well to his going. Don't believe everything you hear. And these days, definitely don't believe everything you see on the internet. That much right now. Just, it's on the internet, therefore it's true, right? The simple believeth every word, but the prudent man looketh well his going. Verse 16, a wise man feareth and departeth from evil, but the fool rageth and is confident. He that is soon angry dealeth foolishly, and a man of wicked devices is hated. Look at verse 18, the simple inherit folly. What's folly? Folly is foolishness. But the prudent are crowned with knowledge. We don't want to be simple. When you're simple, you believe everything you hear. One of the things, and kind of what prompted this sermon, I was talking to a few people earlier this week just about how I was going to preach a sermon because, and I'll tell the story to everybody here. Who here is not familiar with the Black Hebrew Israelite movement? You don't really know anything about it. You haven't heard anything about it before. Has everyone kind of heard of that? It's not like it's this big thing. It's gotten a little bit more attention, it seems, online lately, as other foolish things do from time to time. But I decided not to preach a sermon about this just because I really think that some of the dumbest people in the world literally buy into that type of stuff. And this is what prompted me to preach a sermon on the sin of stupidity. Because unfortunately, people are so, not just ignorant, so dumb that they'll believe whatever they hear for various reasons, right? There's a lot of deceivers out there that use all kinds of different methods to appeal to someone. And in this case, it happens to be race. One of the oldest things in the book to appeal to, right? Oh, you're part of this group, join with us. You know, you get this sense of belonging to somebody and this sense of importance because you're this race. Racism has been around forever. It's not going anywhere. But that's ultimately what that Black Hebrew Israelite movement boils down to. It's just a bunch of racists. They're no less racist than the KKK. Just under a different color. That's all it is. So they appeal to the dumb people who don't want to look up the Bible for themselves, who can't challenge what they're being told, who just accept everything that they hear, and someone comes to them and says, oh yeah, the Bible says this and this. See, you're really a Hebrew. You're really physically a Jew as a Black person. Because that makes a lot of sense. I mean, this is why I don't want to preach a whole sermon about this, because it's just kind of like the premises are so mind-bogglingly stupid. And you have to have really like a negative education to buy into this stuff. I don't know how else to say it. I mean, it's kind of like there's always someone that'll buy into this stuff. It's like how does someone not see the just over-the-top charlatan, the snake oil salesman, right? That's just, everything about him screams, hi, I'm a fraud. All I care about is your money. Yet there's people that will still buy into it and still follow it because they're deceiving themselves or because they're just really not smart at all and they don't even know how to challenge what the things are being told. And that's a shame. And unfortunately, I have a little bit of sympathy. I feel bad for the people that fall into this type of stuff. I do. Because there's so many predators out there just preying on their stupidity. But we got to make sure that we're not stupid, that we could understand what's going on and use our brains that God has given us to get a little bit of wisdom, get some knowledge, get some instruction, and hold on to it and challenge the things that we're confronted with. I believe that being stupid is literally going to prevent some people from even getting saved. Because they're carried about into some cult, to some, you know, brainwashed somewhere by whoever. Sure. I mean, that alone is just, they're not able to even to logic and reason and comprehend and just see the, you know, what's going on around them. And that's sad. We ought not to be like that. God doesn't want us to be like that. He didn't intend for us to be like that. He wants us to be smart. He doesn't want us to not be able to use our brains. So if you go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Some instruction from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 14, the Bible reads, "But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them." And again, knowing the source, right? I preached an entire sermon about this not that long ago of your sources of information, knowing where you're getting them from, especially when you're talking about religion, we're talking about the Bible. You want to learn more about anything about God, about the Bible. Who's the source? Where are you getting your information from? What do they believe? What are they like? What do they do? Who is the source? Continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, right? The things that you've tested and you know you are sure that they are true, and knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Verse 15, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. God's word is valuable for instruction, and it's so valuable that just hearing and knowing the Holy Scriptures is enough to make you wise unto salvation, to get saved through faith, knowing enough to just be saved by the faith of God. We have an epidemic of stupidity in this country. There's a lot of deceivers out there. There always has been. There's always going to be people out there trying to fool someone else, which is why it's so important to be smart. There's people out there causing mischief. There's wicked people that want to do harm to other people, that want to take advantage of other people. And one of the best ways to do that is to take advantage of someone's ignorance or stupidity, that people just fall for whatever you tell them. Scams are always going to be going on and always going to be happening. Now, I think one of the big problems for the epidemic we're seeing, though, these days, is that, I mean, things have gotten way worse, is that the kids these days are not being taught to think critically. At least the ones that are going to the government indoctrination centers. And this started happening even when I was going to school some 30 years ago. And I didn't know it at the time. I was just a kid. What do I know? But looking back on it, and I don't even think necessarily my teachers were really thinking about it or privy to it, but the way that it worked when I went to school, when I went to public school, they teach you to be obedient and to regurgitate whatever it is that you're told. I did not have good critical thinking skills. That was not something that was taught to me. I was not taught to challenge what I was being told. It was, this is right. You do this, and that's it. Now, at some level, you have to start with that, right? 1 + 1 = 2. But you can still reason with that and show them, here's one, 1 + 1 = 2, right? I mean, you could demonstrate that. But the way that I was taught, and this is why by the time I grew up, I had the understanding and the idea that anyone who thought that evolution wasn't true was an idiot. I said, you're a moron. You don't understand science. You're pretty stupid. And I was the one that was stupid, because I just received everything that I was told. Because the textbook said, hey, millions of years ago, there was, you know, this is what happened, and there was this big bang, and everything came into existence from nothing, and, oh, wait, yeah, don't focus about that part, but there was this big bang, that's how it all got here, and that's why you could see certain things the way you do, and here's, the, you know, this reason, you know, explains that, but let's move on to something else, and you all came from monkeys. See, look, here's an image of a monkey getting straighter and straighter and becoming a man. See, look, that makes sense. That's not science. But you're being told that that's true. I was taught the theory of evolution was a fact. Not once did anyone ever say, you know what, this might not be true. This is what somebody thinks. Based on some, you know, some reason, some whatever evidence they came up with, that's a conclusion they drew. That's not what I was told. This is fact. This is where we came from. You want to know where we came from? The origins of life? Came from a single-celled organism. Who's heard that before? Came from a single-celled organism. How'd that get there? Well, we don't exactly know, but there was these amino acids, and it rained, and lightning struck, and then boom, there it is, single-celled organism. And then after millions of years, you know, after a long time, I mean, this stuff doesn't happen overnight. Millions and millions, and maybe even a billion years. Those single-celled organisms, they bump into each other, they bump into the rocks, boom, lightning strike, oh, now it's a multi-cell organism. And it goes on and on until it grows into bananas and monkeys and you know, flowers and whatever. It's nonsense. Now look, I know I'm being a little silly with it, but that really, ultimately, that's what it boils down to. When you look at the science of the matter, I'm going to preach an entire sermon on this later too, because I when I first got saved, when I was 20 years old, I got saved, I knew immediately, because I had that attitude, because I thought I was so smart, because I was so lifted up, and I thought that everything that I had received was true. And I had complete faith in nonsense. That the things that I was taught were true and they were a lie. I was lied to. I was deceived. I was swindled. Because I didn't challenge what I was being told and I didn't think critically about it. And for esteeming myself to be so smart and so scientific and so evidence-based and provable and everything else, I had the wool pulled over my eyes. I was stupid. It wasn't until after I got the light of the gospel shined in my heart to illuminate me with any type of wisdom where I started to think, wow, at least when I was able to accept Christ as my Savior, because I wasn't too stupid to realize I was a sinner that needed to be saved, and I heard the truth and accepted it, then I started to think a little bit more critically and challenge the belief and say, well, wait a minute now, because that was almost instant for me, was what about evolution? Because I was so staunch science. Started to do a little bit more research than what I had just been told. And thinking about things scientifically. And you know what I found out? The radiocarbon 14 dating, that is just fact. You know what that is? Fiction. Assumption. Garbage science. They fit assumptions at the ground level. So the testing technique to make it fit whatever they want it to say. You have no, I mean, when you could take a testing model, and you think about how scientific it is, when you could take a living organism and say, date this, and it comes back as a million years old or 6,000 years old, and pieces from the same exact thing, and one's measurement says it's 6,000 years old, this one says it's 50 years old. Yeah, you've got a real scientific method there. You got a real strong foundation there. But you know what? They don't tell you that in the textbook. They don't tell you that in school. I never heard that before. When I found that, I verified that. There's all kinds of things you can read all over the place. There's people write books, people write papers, people write things on the internet. Maybe you're saying things I'm saying today. Look it up for yourself. Find it. And at the end of the day, you could say, well, I don't know. Maybe this person who did this study is lying. I don't know. At some point, you're going to have to take things on faith when it comes to a lot of this stuff. Is the person who wrote this paper and is peer-reviewed or whatever, okay, they got a lot of friends that'll back them up. Does that mean that it's true? 100% without a doubt? No. I mean, you can be reasonable about things. You say reasonably, yeah, sure, that seems right. You can read history books. I'm not saying not to read any books or not to read history, but think about it. How much do you really know for a fact? And how much do you that you read is someone else's worldview and what they think and what they believe, but isn't necessarily fact. And you look at even scientific studies and all these other things, there's biases all over the place. But no, the kids these days, they're not taught to think critically and to challenge. They used to be. I believe that. I heard that. I've heard that from old timers, people who used to go to school, that, you know what, we were taught different. We were taught to figure things out and to kind of do it on, you know, a little bit more, but do it on your own and some guidance, but figure it out and learn it and gain that wisdom and that understanding and challenging things as opposed to just you sit down, you shut up, you've got ADHD, we're going to put you on drugs, you sit still, you learn, you know, you just receive what I'm giving you. And I'll tell you what, I was a good student in the sense of I could regurgitate what I was told very well. I got A's, B, you know, honors, high honors, all that stuff. Wasn't a very good critical thinker, though. Could retain some information, but was the information even true? I don't know. I can repeat it back to you, though, and that's what the school system wants for you to be able to do. Repeat this back to me. And then whatever agenda is being pushed, whatever textbooks they go with, whatever the culture is at the time, whatever the climate is, and the government saying, here are your restrictions, here's what you need to be able to teach, here's the testing, here's what they need to know. And that's what's getting taught. It's not just the kids, though. I mean, that's bad enough. That's just the way, you know, the way that kids are being taught has changed to where you just kind of being, you know, ultimately told to believe whatever they're just being told and not critically thinking. But even adults seem to be too lazy these days to research, to fact check, to look things up, to use your brain, to take the effort required to go and do that, and end up just spreading lies. I mean, social media is the easy way to do that. You read an article, boom. Some people don't even read articles, and they just post them up, and they just spread them around like it's, I like what that says. Well, that must be true. Be careful of that. You're part of the problem if you don't, you know, if you just start just spreading a bunch of stuff and just, you know, for other people, hey, read this. You know, it's good. You don't want to be caught just spreading a bunch of lies. I saw something a while ago. And some things you see, it's just like, they just reek, you know, something's not right with that. I don't even remember the exact example. Something to do with like Pokemon and the creator of Pokemon and, you know, not, you know, being a God hater or something, and this testimony of him rejecting Christ. And I was just like, this just doesn't even make sense. Like, why would it? And it was supposed to be, it was this article, and they were quoting some other article. Supposedly, they say, well, in this person's interview with someone from Time magazine, right, he said this and this and this, and this was like on some blog post, and like a bunch of people had shared it. So I looked at it, and I was like, it just doesn't make sense that he'd even say those things. You know, something just kind of sparked. I'm like, that doesn't make sense. So what I do, they said, oh, okay, well, we got these quotes from this. I looked it up, found the exact interview they're talking about. Total lie. They just made up whatever and just publish it online and just spread it around, and people are just starting to spread one after the other. It's like, okay, I'm not a Pokemon fan, and I don't think that they're, you know, that it's godly or you know, anything like that. But you don't need to make up stuff in order to make it look worse than it is or whatever. Just, you know, that doesn't do anyone any good to spread lies. And we need to be able to just constant. Now, is that some big deal? No, but the big deal is the lack of effort, the laziness, the not willing to just challenge whatever it is, that, whether it fits your worldview or not, challenge it and say, is this true or not? Is this right? Is this the truth? We need to make sure you're a Word of Truth Baptist Church. We care about the truth. We care about wisdom and knowledge and understanding. We exalt that. We think that's important. Let's not be found being found a liar because you're just sharing disinformation about things. Be careful about where you get your stuff from. Now, you're not always going to know whether something's truth, the information you receive, is as good as it is. I mean, especially if it's coming from the government or it's coming from some other country or something. We hear about these strikes on Syria recently. Do you really know that that even happened? I don't know. I mean, I think it did. I'm not saying it didn't. But where's your source from? I don't know. I don't know anyone firsthand that saw it. I don't have a testimony that way. I just rely on some other witnesses and just believe from a certain source that, well, I think this person's pretty reputable. Take it for what it is, okay? And you have to be aware of that. I'm not saying it's wrong to read the news or anything. Just we need to start using our brains and thinking real critically because there's a lot of people out there to deceive. Everywhere. I mean, at all aspects. Politically, religiously, financially, whatever. There's people always trying to deceive. I think, I forgot I had that in my notes. We're talking about the epidemic of stupidity in this country. And it's easily measured today. When I just look at the bizarre phenomenon where people actually believe that the earth is flat, I think that's an indication of kind of how far things have gone and how easily people are deceived into not able to challenge and think. I mean, you see videos on YouTube and people just jump and say, wow, yeah, I saw this video on YouTube though, man. I mean, the world's flat. It's a big deception. You understand? You're being lied to. I mean, you got to watch this video, man. Got to watch this video. I watched the video. Stupid. I'm not kidding. It was stupid. You could prove this stuff. I mean, you could literally prove it with real science, with provable science. I mean, you could do these things, and it's. But so many people. I mean, Christians too. Just hook, line, and sinker. Not able to use just. A little bit of reasoning skills, a little bit of understanding, just some real science. Maybe not even willing to test it for yourself. Check the formula that they're giving you. Is that true? Is it being applied properly? Even better, say, is it? Well, yeah, I saw that same formula somewhere else. They're using the right formula. Are they applying it right? Because that's what most of it is when we're trying to test the curvature of the earth. It's misapplied. It's not being used properly. They're using the wrong formula for what they're trying to state is then the result of, well, this is the curvature and everything like that. It's stupid. I mean, I'm not going to go into that whole thing. If that's something that you believe, I feel sorry for you. You got to talk to me. I'll try to set you straight on it, but don't just believe every YouTube video you see or anything, everything you see on the video, even if it sounds a little compelling. Look into it for yourself. God doesn't want us to. Turn, if you would, to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. God doesn't want us to be dumb. He wants us to have wisdom. I mean, the whole book of Proverbs is a book of wisdom and instruction. We had a whole Bible study about going through every chapter. And literally almost every chapter talks about the importance of having wisdom and having instruction. We need to hold a high standard for our children. We need to hold a high standard for ourselves on the level of education they're going to receive, on the level of critical thinking skills that they're going to have, ourselves and them included. And say, well, I never really had a good education. Get smart now. It's never too late to learn. And to just gain some more knowledge and some more understanding. It's never too late for that. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, the Bible says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. God has gifted people to be teachers in order for all of us to receive instruction, to learn, to get smarter, to get wisdom, to get knowledge. Verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lay in wait to deceive. There's a lot of people out there trying to deceive. I mentioned that already. And children are a good example of being able to deceive them, right? You could pull all kinds of things past children. Why? Because they're kind of naive. They don't know that much. And especially if you want to go and fool them, they have such an innocent heart that they don't realize how wicked people can be. And that's not part, they haven't learned that really, especially by experience, hopefully, right? I mean, any child still has their innocence. Like my children, you know, if I were to just start lying to my kids, they would believe whatever I told them. But that's because I'm not a wicked person. I'm not trying to deceive my children. I'm not saying it's bad for them to believe me necessarily, but they're easy to deceive. If I wanted to, they'd be very easy to deceive because they're children. We ought not to be like children, though, and just that easy to deceive. We ought not to be tossed about to and fro, carried about with every wind and doctrine. Oh, this person said this thing from the Bible, and look, but they use some Bible verses. But is it right? Is it true? Are they applying it correctly? We need to challenge that and think about it. You don't have to turn there, but in Romans 16, turn if you would to Proverbs chapter 1. Proverbs chapter 1. Romans 16, 17 says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses, contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them." So mark these people that are just trying to sway you from what you already have learned, what you already know, what you things you already know to be true. Mark them, avoid them, have nothing to do with them. Verse number 18, "For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly. And by good words and fair speeches..." This is what they use. Good words. It sounds great. Fair speeches. They're really good with their words. They're real slick. So they use good words and fair speeches to deceive the hearts of the simple. Doesn't deceive the hearts of everybody, but it definitely deceives the hearts of the simple. We don't want to be simple. We need to learn. We need to value instruction. You need to place an importance on, one, reading your Bible every day, making sure you have that instruction regularly coming through. And not even just the Bible. I think, you know, there's ways of practice using reasoning skills and logic to make sure that you could, you know, understand and reason well to not be fooled. Proverbs 24:9 says, "The thought of foolishness is sin, and the scorner is an abomination to men." But even the thought of foolishness is a sin. Proverbs 1. Look at Proverbs 1. We're going to go through this a little bit. Verse number 20. Bible reads, "Wisdom crieth without. She uttereth her voice in the streets. She crieth in the chief place of concourse. In the openings of the gates in the city, she uttereth her word, saying, How long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity? And the scorners delight in their scorning, and fools hate knowledge. Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you." Wisdom is available for anyone who's looking for it, anyone who's willing to receive instruction, anyone who's willing to receive some rebuke, to be told that you're wrong, to see the truth from Scripture, from God's Word. You know, let's not be simple ones. Let's not love being stupid. Let's not love our simplicity. But let's turn, let's change, let's get right with God, get right with His words, and have a spirit poured out unto us. Verse number 24, "Because I have called and ye refused, I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded. But ye have set at naught all my counsel and would none of my reproofs." So there's people who don't want to have wisdom, who are willfully ignorant, don't want to receive instruction, don't want to receive reproof, don't want to be told they're wrong. Verse 26, "I also will laugh at your calamity," because a calamity will come when you decide to be a fool and not listen to knowledge. "I will mock when your fear cometh, when your fear cometh as desolation and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind. When distress and anguish cometh upon you, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me, for that they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. They would none of my counsel, they despised all my reproof. Therefore shall they eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices, for the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. But whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil. The turning away from knowledge, the simple that doesn't want to receive the truth of God, doesn't want to be told they're wrong, doesn't want to accept that there is a God, there's a God in heaven, there's a God that judges, and there's a God that loves us and has given his own son for us. You want to reject all that, hate the knowledge, would none of my counsel, despise the reproof, the turning away of the simple is going to slay him. It's going to kill him. If you want to be simple in your beliefs and not just accept the truth, that simplicity will end up destroying you. Turn if you would to Proverbs chapter 7. We'll see an example of a simple person being caught in a trap. Because they're simple. Because they don't know what to look for. They don't know that there's people out there trying to deceive. So they just walk right along and they fall into the trap. Proverbs 7, look at verse number 4. Say unto wisdom, thou art my sister, and call understanding thy kinswoman, that they may keep thee from the strange woman, from the stranger which flattereth with her words. For at the windows of my house I looked through my casement and beheld among the simple ones, I discerned among the youths, a young man void of understanding, passing through the street near her corner. And he went the way to her house in the twilight, in the evening, in the black and dark night. And behold, there met him a woman with the attire of an harlot and subtle of heart. It's talking about this youth, this young man, void of understanding, doesn't have wisdom, doesn't have knowledge. He's among the simple ones. He doesn't know any better. And it's obvious he doesn't know any better. Why? Because of where he's even putting himself into the situation. He's walking in the evening, at dark, in front of the hooker's door. The adulteress, just going right and, I don't know, everything's just fine. Just walk, going down, not using any wisdom, any understanding, trying to stay away and say, you know what, I know that there's women dressed provocatively here. I know there's women here, they're going to be lying and saying whatever they can because they don't care about me, they care about my money, but they're going to pretend to care about me. They're going to use flattery, like it says in verse number 5, from the stranger which flattereth with her words, and try to make me feel good and all these various techniques to deceive me. But the person who's void of wisdom, who's simple, doesn't know any better, would never think, instead of thinking, why is she flattering me so much? Something's not right here. They're going, she really likes me. When she just spent time with another guy like a couple hours ago and said the same exact thing to him because she cares about your money and doesn't care at all about you. She really cares about you. This sounds really good. I could see how she's dressed. Now I really want to do, and just being simple. And going in a trap. And then verse 22, it goes on in that story. Verse number 22 says, he goeth after her straightway as an ox goeth to the slaughter, or as a fool to the correction of the stocks, till a dart strike through his liver, as a bird hasteth to the snare and knoweth not that it is for his life. And just like a dumb animal falls into a trap, because they don't know any better, right? It's easy to trap an ox. Or set up a trap for the bird, for the dart to strike through and kill them when they go and land on whatever it is you're attracting them with. That's how the simple is deceived and brought to nothing. And they don't even know, because you say, what's the big deal? You only spend time with a hooker. Well, you're going to get a disease. You could die from some disease that you could get. Or maybe you're going to run in with some lady there that is married. And that is just an adulterous whore that's doing this thing. And her husband's going to come home and he's going to kill you. Oh, that would never happen. Yeah, right. That would never happen. Simpleton. Get some wisdom. Get some instruction. Let's learn, and let's not have to learn by our experience. Let's receive instruction and learn and get wisdom so that we don't have to go through these things and fall into these traps and be overcome with sorrow. Turn, if you would, to Acts chapter 6. Probably the last place I'll have you turn. Yeah, we're going to spend the rest of the night in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 6. Proverbs 22:23 says, a prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the simple pass on and are punished. You don't have wisdom, you understand, or you're simple, you don't even understand what's going on around you. You can't foresee the evil that's coming and be able to protect yourself and hide yourself like the prudent man does. We need to be more like Stephen. Stephen, I love Stephen, the evangelist Stephen, the deacon Stephen, Stephen the martyr Stephen in the Bible. One of my favorite Bible characters, even though there's not very much about him. I mean, we only see like two chapters worth of Stephen in the New Testament in the book of Acts. But look at verse number 8 of Acts chapter 6. The Bible says in verse number 8, "And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of the Libertines, and Cyrenians, and Alexandrians, and of them of Cilicia and of Asia, disputing with Stephen." So what happens is Stephen's going to work. He's working for the Lord. He's doing a good job. He's full of faith. He's full of power. People are, you know, he's got wonders and miracles. People are being healed. He's preaching the gospel. He's doing a great work. But what happens? These theologians from the synagogue come out and start arguing with him. They're disputing with him. They're challenging him on what he's teaching and what he's saying, what he's preaching. But Stephen wasn't a dummy. Look at verse number 10. The Bible says, "And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake." So they tried disputing with him, but because he had wisdom and because he had the spirit of God, he had a great spirit, he was able to shut them down. Answer them. They had nothing to say after that. Just like Jesus had, you know, when they went to try to trap Jesus Christ in his words, and then he wisely answers them, and they're just like, you know, no man after that durst ask him any more questions. They didn't know what to say to him because he confounded them, because he's way more wise than they were. But if you're simple, you are going to be caught in your words. You're going to fall into their trap. That Jesus was not simple. He saw the trap that was laid out for him by these evil, wicked people that were trying to kill him and stop the good work that he was doing. But he used wisdom. We need to have that wisdom. We gotta watch out for the traps. So how are we going to get smart? Psalm 19:7. Turn if you would to Acts chapter 4. Just turn over a couple of pages there, Acts chapter 4. Psalm 19:7 says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple." So I'm not very smart tonight. The law of the Lord, the testimony of the Lord, the Bible says, is sure, making wise the simple. That's going to give you wisdom. When you see God's morality, when you look at the law and he says, this is wicked, this is sin, this is wrong, this is righteous, this is good, this is pure. Right away, you're going to start getting some really good wisdom on where you should be heading in your life and the decisions you should be making based on that. And they're real simple. The concepts are easy, ultimately. The wisdom comes in when you could recognize it, remember it, keep it in your heart, and use it in your day-to-day life. Acts chapter 4, verse number 13 says, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John," remember, Peter, James, and John were fishermen. "They saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men," talking about, you know, they weren't theologians, they weren't Pharisees, right? They were these unlearned, ignorant fishermen. What do they know? "They marveled." They were astonished. It was like, wow, what are you? These guys got boldness. They're out teaching and preaching. And look at what it says there. "And they took knowledge of them." So they looked at what's going on. They marveled. "They took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus." You spend some time with Jesus. Spend some time with his words. And you could get that spirit and wisdom like Stephen had, like Peter and James had and John, and be able to identify the traps, to not be fooled, not to be swindled, not to be beguiled. Test everything. Challenge it. Please do. Challenge me. And look, I'm the type of pastor where I'll make myself available. If you don't agree with me on something, I'm not going to be mad at you at all, no matter what it is. But and if you're willing to have an honest discussion and just be open about it, I'll talk to you as much as need be. Challenge. Don't just accept what you hear as being fact because I said so. Please don't do that. I want a church full of people who are wise because they took the time and the effort to do their own research and figure it out for themselves. I'll teach you what I can, my own wisdom, what I've learned experientially, and what I've learned through the Bible that I didn't have to go through myself. Take it for what it is, but do your own reading, get your own wisdom, get your own understanding. And don't just accept anything because any one person said so. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this book of wisdom, for all of the learning and instruction, God, that you have for us. Thank you for loving us enough as your creation in general, just to give us what we need to know in order to live a joyful, righteous life, dear God, a fulfilling life, one that's not just void and empty because of sin, but where you can give us the truth and the knowledge and the understanding, be able to discern between what's right and what's wrong, that you've given us what morality is and how we should be making decisions in our life. God, help us open up our understanding, increase our wisdom, increase our knowledge, Lord, and help our souls and our spirits to be stirred up to desire knowledge more and to spend more time in your word, that we could increase that wisdom, dear God. So in Jesus' name we pray, amen.